Welcome back, everyone. The Tech News soft serve machine presents you with myriad flavors each week, but whether you prefer the plain vanilla or a more exotic and pungent variety, I think we can all agree that a nice swirly is the way to go, blending the best and tastiest ingredients together for maximum enjoyment. Kind of like this show, where we cover the most important things you need to know about in the world of PC hardware, creating an impossible concoction that is both immensely satisfying and a bit drippy. To preview, NVIDIA has announced the NVIDIA app to finally replace the archaic UI of their control center. AMD rumors sure do seem to indicate that they'll soon launch the Radeon RX 7900 GRE on a global scale, and Intel has apparently become too successful for just one company, so now they are two companies, but blended together, much like two things that are combined in some pleasing fashion. Oh, yes, like a beer and one of my pint glasses. That's one of the best swirlies I've ever had. Cheers. It's time for tech news.
Excellent.
Today's video is brought to you by the Tower 300 series cases from Thermaltake, expanding their vertical tower design with a stunning new lineup available in a variety of colors. The larger frame now supports micro ATX motherboards as well as huge GPUs, including the RTX 4090, without compromising airflow thanks to an abundance of filtered ventilation panels. Two CT140 fans come pre-installed, and the right side can house up to 420mm AIO radiators. Finish your build off with a sold separately 3.9-inch LCD panel kit, or even go horizontal with a matching chassis stand for a truly unique look. For more on Thermaltake's The Tower 300 series cases, click the sponsor link in the video description. So I tend to criticize NVIDIA a lot, but that ends today. Or that ends for the next 3 or 4 minutes, I should say. I can't give them a free pass forever. But to be completely fair, there are multiple good things that can be said about NVIDIA, such as their treatment of their employees, as indicated by a 4.6 out of 5 rating on Glassdoor, or the 97% positive feedback score as reported by greatplacetowork.com, an impressive feat for a company with more than 10,000 employees. The employees with stock options are probably particularly enthusiastic about working for Team Green, but let's not get distracted. Today's story is about another thing NVIDIA seems to be getting right, and that's the debut and future plans for the NVIDIA app, which went public Thursday with a beta version that's now available for download. Ultimately, NVIDIA plans to roll all the functions of their control panel, RTX experience, and the GeForce experience apps into this single utility, although for now, the control panel, RTX experience, and GeForce experience are still accessible individually. Now, NVIDIA's old control panel is familiar and easy to use, yes, but it has also sported the same UI and basic set of functions for more than 20 years, and it can also be slow to load and apply settings, as demonstrated by Tim from Hardware Unboxed. It's long overdue for a modern update. GeForce Experience, meanwhile, hosts supplemental NVIDIA software features that can optimize game settings, download the latest drivers, or provide tools for broadcasting and streaming, but it required a login to use, which was inconvenient and didn't seem necessary. It's not clear when NVIDIA will do away with the old software solutions entirely, but for now we have entered a transition period where they are allowing the use of both. The initial response to the NVIDIA app beta has been quite positive, I'm pleased to say, with an intuitive layout and most of the expected features you'd need accessible via the menu in the top left. The only part that still needs a login is the Redeem tab, which is where you'd claim free games that come with a GPU, for example, and for that, they do kind of need your contact info. The rest of the interface is login free though, and will hopefully continue to be easy to use and snappy, while also allowing NVIDIA to more easily surface new features they design, like their updated performance overlay or AI boosted RTX vibrance and HDR filters that look pretty nice. So good job, NVIDIA. Thanks for not sucking this week. Now lower your GPU prices. Speaking of lower GPU prices, I am still getting reaccustomed to the 2024 trend of GPUs being somewhat competitively priced and actually in stock, making that whole competition thing come into play, economically speaking. Case in point, the latest rumor from AMD's Radeon team indicates that they are planning to come around for yet another broadside aimed at NVIDIA's flank, specifically the squishy and undefended sub-$600 price range flank, where NVIDIA's competitive GPU options quickly become way less competitive. You might remember the Radeon RX 7900 GRE, or Golden Rabbit Edition, that launched exclusively in China back in July 2023, and while the year of the rabbit has passed, apparently those GRE GPUs wasted no time and have been doing that thing that rabbits are known to do, procreating with great enthusiasm and efficiency. And even though it is now the year of the dragon, AMD appears ready to unleash all those wascally wabbits globally, with 7900 GREs already going up for sale in the UK in the past week, and a US launch happening as early as Tuesday, February 27th, if YouTuber Moore's Law is Dead is to be believed. It might also have a better price, and could sell for $550 MSRP, a $100-ish discount versus the roughly $650 MSRP from the China-only launch last year. And we don't even have to wait for an embargo lift to figure out its performance, since it's already out in some regions. It should outperform the $600 RTX 4070 Super by 5-10% in pure rasterization, while also being $50 cheaper and featuring 4GB more VRAM, 16GB total, as well as a wider memory bus, 256-bit. The $600 RTX 4070 Super will remain the more efficient GPU and will perform more evenly when ray tracing is enabled, but thanks primarily to that price drop, it sounds like AMD will have another noteworthy GPU to consider in the near future. Now they just need an all-white fuzzy bunny version. Speaking of NVIDIA and AMD, what about Intel? Well, it's a beautiful story. Having reached full maturity at last, Intel finally underwent the process of mitosis this week, doubling its chromosomes and jiggling softly and seductively before its cell membrane constricted, and Intel became two, Intel Product and Intel Foundry, as revealed at their Direct Connect event on Wednesday. Both companies will be separate legal entities with their own sales forces and back-end business systems, but will remain part of the same overall company. Intel Foundry will handle the fabs, and will be focused on pushing forward with CEO Pat Gelsinger's vision of shipping products based on 5 different nodes within 4 years, which they say they're still on track for. Intel 7 is already out, Intel 4 is what currently shipping Meteor Lake CPUs are based on, and Intel 3 is in the works along with Intel's 20A, 18A, and also 14A nodes. And while Intel Foundry will be reserving its most bleeding-edge fabs and tech for its own Intel products, you know, the ones designed by Intel Product, they are keen to work with other chip designers so they can recoup their costs for all the fabs that they've been building out. That means NVIDIA, Qualcomm, Google, Microsoft, who has confirmed they'll be using the 18A node, and yes, even AMD might be Intel Foundry customers soon for both chip manufacturing and or packaging, with packaging being one of the areas where there has been a huge amount of advancement recently, with multi-chip solutions providing a cost-effective way for manufacturers to combine chiplets, stack cache, and leverage new power delivery methods like backside power delivery to maximize efficiency. It will be fascinating to see this play out in the coming months and years, and I'll be watching to see if Intel slips back into a competitive mindset or maintains its magnanimous stance as a foundry for the world. Foundry for the world. What a miss! They should have called the new company Global Foundries. It's a joke because there's already a company called Global Foundries, which is AMD's fab unit that they spun off years and years ago. Occasionally, the tech news happens too fast, which is why I always keep a high frame rate security camera running so we can play it back in slow-mo here on Tech Briefs. AMD's Zen 5 CPU architecture will likely debut in next-gen Ryzen CPUs launching later this year, but before you can say, it's over 9000, we have early benchmarks already leaking. The AM5-based Ryzen 9000 series flagship, which will probably be called the Ryzen 9 9950X, can apparently hit a Cinebench R23 single-thread score of 2800, per Twitter leaker Zyman Winerski, as relayed by YouTuber Red Gaming Tech, also named Paul. That's a 40% improvement just with single-threaded performance over the current 7950X, which scores around 2060 in the same test, and about a 19% win over the 14900K's typical score of 2350. These are, of course, very early rumors, but hopefully they're not complete bullshit. Perhaps even more dubious slash exciting than Zen 5 rumors are Zen 6 rumors, though, and here, once again, we lean on Twitter leaks. Per at Ulrak29_, this very official-looking graph paper diagram is how the PlayStation 6 APU might be configured, with 8 Zen 6D cores on one chiplet, with another chip hosting GDDR7 VRAM and RDNA 5 based iGPU, and four more Zen 6 low power cores. And while that sketch might just be the baseless remnants of a fever dream, the follow-up comment is both more interesting and at least slightly more likely that CPUs codenamed Medusa, AMD's next-gen client lineup, will have RDNA5-based integrated graphics, a well-proportioned and competitively priced entry-level APU with hardware based on these specs would be quite appealing, methinks, but we'll likely have to wait until 2025 or even 2026 to find out. Medusa might be the final CPU family that launches on the AM5 platform. Getting back to current events, do you have an RTX 40 series GPU? Maybe even one of the new super models? And if you do, do you know what kind of a power connector it has? Many gamers assumed that since power supply manufacturers are all rushing to upgrade their power supplies to ATX 3.1, which would mean a 12V 2x6 connector instead of the historically untrustworthy 12VH power connector, that newer GPUs would do the same. But nay, it is not so. Some do, yes, but many do not. And thanks to @WXNod on Twitter, an easy way to determine the difference exists. Just check the housing for your power connector and you should see an engraving. If it says H+, you have an older 12VH power connector, which is probably fine for any non-RTX 4090 GPU. And even for those, just make sure it's plugged in all the way and do not bend it severely and don't breathe on it or think negative thoughts around it either, for that matter. If it says H++, on the other hand, it's a 12V 2x6 connector and you can rest easy knowing that your GPU is getting power via the second best method available. Best method being regular ass 8-pin peg connectors that have been around forever that NVIDIA should have gone with in the first place. Here's an interesting one. Biometric security, specifically the fingerprint-based version, is slightly less secure now thanks to a paper published by a group of researchers from China and the US. It details Print Listener, a side channel attack that listens to the sound your finger makes when it slides across a touchscreen or a fingerprint reader, and it uses that data to recreate your fingerprint. Mind-blowing. Yes, but fortunately, the success rate was relatively low, reproducing up to 27.9% of partial fingerprints and 9.3% of complete fingerprints within 5 attempts, per the researchers. Fingerprint-based security has its flaws, but is still widely trusted. Hopefully, these attacks don't start showing up in the wild so we can continue fingering our devices with impunity. We end today with an epic saga. Many years ago, the CPU cooler wars began with Asetek suing a bunch of other companies for daring to combine a pump and a CPU block in the same housing. Asetek has a patent for that, you jerks, so no copycats. And now, many years later, one of the companies that Asetek sued, Cooler Master, is also suing a bunch of other companies for daring to combine a pump and a radiator in the same housing. Cooler Master has a patent for that, you jerks, so no copycats. CM is suing Silverstone, Enermax, and the China-based OEM Apaltech, who builds AIOs for Silverstone and Enermax. Cooler Master has not named MSI in the suit, even though Apaltech makes AIOs for MSI as well, likely because MSI has a bigger and more formidable legal team. But this might be another reason why I am lukewarm on AIO coolers, personally. Sure, the pump can fail and brick your OS install, but you know what I really like about air coolers? Just way less drama. But there you have it, guys, tech news for the week, and if you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high-quality merchandise, t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call, too. Thank you again for watching this video, and for all the things you do for me. I'm gonna drink some more beer. We'll see you all next week.